Thank you very much, Foodom UK, for inviting me here, first of all, yeah. And the introduction about me, I am Antonio. I come from a background of research in 3D computer graphics. And for the last 14 years, I've been working as an independent 360 degree content creator. Okay. My web, takato.com, and my Twitter there as well, yeah. What can I show you in 15 minutes? Not much time, really, but what I want to try to do is show you the way I capture, the way I'm approaching 360 video capturing by using standard panoramic techniques. And to do so, I'm going to walk through an example. I'll show you that example in a minute. And I'm also trying to do some live capturing with my current setup, which is this one here. I'm already capturing now. Okay. So let me start by showing you an example of the sort of thing I can do with this setup. This full 360 degree video. No parallax. And this is the example I'm going to go through. So hopefully by the end of my 15 minutes, you will get a clear idea of how this can be approached. Okay, so 360 video, as I knew, when I first started my research about 360 degree video, I used a paraboloid mirror to find out that the quality was just too low. So I continued trying to search for methods to record 360 video and found the multi-camera approach. Problem with multi-camera is that they are expensive, they tend to be very expensive. They have parallax, you are never rotating about the non-parallax point. Not sure if this is a very technical term for some of you. White balance of each camera is different, exposure is different, the dynamic range of that sort of sensors is not that high, so you're not creating, in my opinion, very nice quality images. And then you have a sync thing of the different images into just one frame, yeah? So there are a few problems, yeah, with that approach. How I'm approaching 360 degree video? In the year 2012, after doing some of my research about multi-camera, I realized that I couldn't afford to invest $15,000 into a Ladybug camera, yeah? That was too expensive for me. Then I got a new camera, this one here, it's a Canon Mark II. That could record video, yeah. And at the same time, since I've been shooting panoramics for many years, I had fisheye lenses, I had the hardware required for it, and I have long panel experience, yeah. So I thought, okay, why not use a single camera with a fisheye lens, my panel head, and create full 360 degree video. How to do that then? Okay, I thought I'm gonna follow the same procedure I do for capturing my images, my panoramic images, which is an image capturing part. Basically, you just rotate over the nodal point and you have some overlapping. Then you have some stitching over those images to put them together into a full equirectangular frame. And then some image channeling for enhancing, masking, correcting, ghosting, all those sort of like little like things that affect these sort of images. So image capturing, the basic way of capturing 360 degree images when it comes to photos is to shoot and rotate, okay? For video, what I do is rather than shooting, I record. So for instance, if I move here now, the way you shoot a panoramic photo, would be to shoot, rotate, I'm rotating over the nodal point, and that's a panoramic photo, yeah? For the video, what I do, I keep on over the nodal point, and rather than taking a photo, I press and record video. Now it's recording video. So I'm taking a photo, and I'm taking a video, okay? Now let me show you the example we're gonna see here. This would be the photo, first photo, second photo, third photo,
four, five, and six.
In this case, I've taken four. This was a six photo around panel, yeah? And then also the videos. This will be one of the videos. Second video. Shooting a photo, I record a video. So, okay, so we capture the photo on one side and at the same time we capture the video. Second part is the image stitching part. And this is a tricky part. It's a part where like people think that it gets very complicated. But what I do is I use the source images that I've captured. One extra step that I need to take is stripping the videos into separate frames. So this will be the first video. Second video. Yeah, it's the source of the whole video. And third video. So I have separate frames. I have the six photos and frames for all the videos. Image stitching. This is the normal stuff with panoramic images. You put the images into a stitcher and you put them all together. What I do in my technique is I use the panoramic photo as a background, static background. If you observe most of 360 videos, more than half of the videos are static. It's only like movement in some parts of it. So I use the photo as a background, and then at the same time, I throw three frames from each video into that background and I stitch it together. And I'll show you the example, so hopefully it will make sense. So for the image stitching part, I use pretty good for this. There's some other possibilities as well. So as you see, I'm just showing the six photos and three of the frames. And I just let the program do its job, just putting all those together into just one frame. And this is the final result. So what we see here is the six images that will form the background. Yeah. And then we have one frame from the video that nicely sticks to that background, the second video and the third video. Okay? Other than that, much more than that. Put it on the software and it will automatically fix it onto the background. So, what do we do after this? Okay, let me use the part there. This file here, in pretty good, has all the details to be applied into each of the frames of each video to reproduce this effect, yeah? To reconvert it into a rectangular frame that will nicely fit into the background. This is only for one frame of each video, but what I do is I use this as a template and I replicate that. Yeah. So you can do that if you go into this software, you have the tools and you have batch stitcher and batch builder. So this would be my main template to be applied over all files. So if I do that, in each of the videos, I end up with this. People tend to think that you have to do this for each frame in the video, which will take ages. You just do it only for one frame, and then you replicate that information into the rest of that one video. Yeah. So this would be a quadrangular projection of that video. I'll show you the second video. Okay. and a third video. And now, where the magic kind of comes, yeah?
Image sending.
What do I do now with all this? Okay, I'm gonna put it together into one single video file. Okay, so to do that, I'm gonna move into Photoshop. Photoshop is pretty nice for videos. I'm gonna open as an image sequence. And what we have here now is an image sequence of that one. Okay? So it's Photoshop. I can apply masks. I will apply a mask. So I'm assembling the three separate videos and the background into just one thing. So this will be one video. If I replicate the same thing for the second video, apply a mask to it. And now I mix these two, just one. And the whole thing starting to get there. And one last video. Sometimes I record three videos, sometimes I just need two, sometimes I need four. It really depends on the subject. Last one here. At this point, we have all three videos, and we're just lacking the background, really. So out of the template, I've also created a background, which is just a standard panel. Just this one here. I've corrected the zenith and the nadir, which is just normal panoramic stuff. If I put this background panel at the back of our video, we have the full 360 degree video. Okay, I'm gonna open that. I mean, I've done it pretty fast here. I'll show you normally this step requires some more time to tweak the masks a little bit better. And also, you can do, I'll show you here, we have the background. Nothing moves here. Then if I set up on top of that background the videos, some last patches, correct some things, I'm also light enhancing. Okay? So the result of all this, when you render it into, you can also put some sound layer on Photoshop and it will add it to the video. So the result is this thing, which is the video that we started with. This is in a rectangular format. As I said, if you observe most of the videos out there, there's no movement on the zenith, there's no movement on the nadir. So this is a nice way of creating, and I'll go to one of my last slides here. Okay, you've seen the way we constructed the image, three videos, mask, background, and then the sound. Some conclusions about this technique. I think it's pretty simple technique based on panoramic photography. And I'm kind of giving talks about this technique because I think it can benefit others trying to create HD content. Okay? It's a good price, it's camera independent. I'm using Canon, you could use Nikon, you could use anything, you could even use a single GoPro. Whatever camera you have, if it's got a fisheye. If you have a fisheye lens, you will not require as many videos. So that's the point of using a fisheye. You can get high quality. Yeah, you could even use a red camera if you want. It's parallax free, yeah. And it's got some cons as well, yeah. It's in static position all of the time. It's not good for uncontrolled situations with this loss of movement. Because as you've seen, I'm recording only one part of the video, so if something comes out of frame, that's 360 video ghosting. Yeah, that's a problem, yeah. So therefore, it's not good for action shots, where you always probably require a multi-camera. That's why there's a lot of scripting involved with this technique, and that's why I like it to call, I tend to call it 360 cinema more than 360 video, because it resembles more cinema in the way that you have to control things, control life. And as I said, it's all about content. So if you think carefully about this technique and how to build content, probably you will be able to do so with this technique without the need to invest into something more expensive. Yeah. Some extra experimentation, I think I've gone a little bit over the time. But if I have a couple of extra minutes, I'm going to show you some extra experiments that I've done, 1 minute, okay, that I've done with this technique. You can play also with focus stacking. This is a 360 degree video recorded over an end hole. So we only 1 centimeter from the anhole, yeah? And then we have a horse there, so we are focusing at different parts of the image. You couldn't do this with a multi-camera system, okay? Let me just go over another example. This is a little example also I did, because I mean, as I said, if you come out of frame, yeah, you have ghosting. But this was a test I did rotating around the camera. So it's a similar approach, one single camera, rotating around the camera. And you see it's parallax free, which is something complicated. High dynamic, as I said, you can play with a nice sensor, so you can get pretty nice dynamic range. Something that with multi-cameras is pretty complicated. And I tell you that what we see here is not that high dynamic on the projector right now, yeah. But I tell you that you would play around a lot with the values here to get the most out of each pixel. And a final one, and with this I'll finish, is artistic approaches, yeah. Over here you see the technique. We recorded four videos, and this is a sculpture, yeah. And it was just following the thing. So you clearly see here that it's 4 recordings. Yeah. So that's all for me. Thank you. And if you have